All right, you ready for the message? Lord, bless this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Here we go. We've got a few comedians tonight sitting in the rows here. Who's that? All right. So last week was Vision Friday. And if you missed out last week Friday, you missed out. You missed out. You missed out on the vision for the year. So can I encourage you, jump onto YouTube and go check it out. You definitely don't want to miss it. It is life-changing. It paves the way for the year. It sets us up for what we want to do in and through this year. Justin shared an incredible message of how we see shift and surge. The youth ministry we see a youth ministry that's so incredible that when people walk in there, encounter Jesus, their life transforms. We want to help you to grow closer to Jesus. We want you to be leaders. And tonight, where's Alonzo? Alonzo, would you mind standing up 2 seconds? Alonzo, stand up so we can see you. That's Alonzo. You said you were nervous. You can grab your seat. Alonzo actually did incredibly well. He's going to be representing Gauteng in pool in July, I believe. And we want to build a youth ministry filled with people like Alonzo who are achieving excellence in school, in sports, in academics. And I promise you, if you press in, that's what's going to happen, right? But if you hold back, if you put on your too cool for school jacket, and you think, why am I here, man? I'm just too cool for this place. What is Brendan going to tell me? Ah, man, I already know everything. Well, good luck to you. But for those who are ready to press in, those who are ready for a life change, your life will change. So today we're going to be carrying on with Unshkable. Now, I'm at that age. I don't cry in movies anymore. Finally, Chantal. Finally, I'm at a movie where I don't cry anymore. So when Disney movies play, I don't cry anymore. I don't cry. When sad parts happen in Disney movies, I don't cry. So when I watch The Lion King, I don't cry anymore. I don't cry. Now, I'm not talking about the new Lion King movie, because that one doesn't count. That wasn't a movie. I'm talking about the original Lion King, the OG. And now, for those of you who doesn't know what Lion King is, Lord, we just pray for those people that your lightning bolt will be fast and effective, that they won't suffer, but they will see you this afternoon. Right, so Lion King, just to give you some context about Lion King, it's about this young lion who grows up singing, oh, he can't wait to be king. He then has some daddy issues. He starts disobeying his dad, and he starts going through a little bit of a rebellious season. He then has this conversation with his uncle, and his uncle starts whispering some things in his ear, and he does exactly what his dad asks him not to do, and it gets him into trouble. Ultimately, his dad dies, right? Then he goes on this whole identity crisis. He forgets who he is. He meets a warthog and a meerkat, and they start talking to him, and then he realizes it means no worries for the rest of his days. Hakuna Matata, you've seen it. And then all of a sudden, he hits this moment in his life when he doesn't realize who he is. He hits a bit of a moment in his life where he doesn't know what to do. Now, I'm sure there's many of us in this room who can relate where we hit this moment where we don't know what to do. We don't know how to go forward. School gets tough. Perhaps you're fighting with your parents. There's a bit of a challenge going on. And you just need a breakthrough. This is an incredibly iconic moment in The Lion King where Simba meets his dad in the sky. He speaks to his dad. He thought his dad was dead. He meets this crazy monkey, and this monkey says, no, your dad's alive. He's like, what? Then he follows this monkey, and he speaks to his dad, and he has this incredible encounter. So let's have a look at the screens.
Sure do, your Mufasa's boy. Bye.
Hey, wait. You knew my father?
Correction, I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope, wrong again.
He's alive, and I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki, he knows the way. Come on. Don't dawdle. Hurry up!
Hey, whoa, wait.
Come on. Come on!
Would you slow down?
Stop!
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
Truly an iconic moment in film history. Simba has this moment with his father where his father says, remember who you are. Can I encourage you that if we are going to build unshakable faith, we need to know who we are, but also we need to know whose we are. So often we want to do life, we want to achieve our goals, but we forget who we are. So the moment that something happens, we start giving up, we start quitting, school starts getting so tough. But if we know who we are and whose we are, we truly can live a unshakable life, but we'll have unshakable faith in Jesus. So when hardships come, hey, we've got an unshakable faith in Jesus. And what's so incredible is that tonight, as we paint the picture, can I encourage you that if you know who you are, you'll know whose you are, and therefore you're able to achieve all that you have. So think about the goals you set in January this year. Perhaps you are in grade 8. Or if you're in grade 8, then you're in the wrong room. But perhaps you're in grade 9. Now you're in grade 9 and you said, you know, this year I want to achieve these marks at school. I want to make first team cricket. I want to make first team hockey. I want to do great things. And then now we're in February and you're like, please, Lord Jesus, can this year end? Perhaps you are in matric this year and you thought, you know what, this year I'm going to make the best of it. And now you start getting to your first cycle test. You're like, Lord, wow, I missed grade 11. But if we remember whose we are, we'll truly step into significance. And, you know, as we lived out this year, I don't know what you're going through, but can I encourage you? The Word of God is going to help you get through anything. Now, as we dive into this, it's so important that, you know, we pray for an encounter with God. I love what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15:58. So now, beloved ones, if you see a word bolded on the screen, say it out loud with me. So now, beloved ones, stand firm and live your lives with. So who are the beloved ones? Exactly, us. Look to the person next to you and say, beloved one. That's not a pickup line, please. We are beloved ones. Stand firm and secure. Do you know what that means? When you stand firm, you don't move. You don't move, you don't shake. When the wind comes, you don't move, you don't quit. When people say, ah, jeepers, I actually don't think you're good enough. You don't crawl up into a ball and start crying. Why? Because you're standing firm and secure. And here's the reason why. Live your lives with unshakable confidence. We need to make sure that we have unshakable confidence in who? Jesus. Can I encourage you, the song we sang today, Rest on Us, it simply means, Lord, we want your presence to rest on us. Rest on us. When God's presence rests on you, you might think, flip. It's tough right now, but I can get through it. Because God's presence resting on you. The moment you start wanting to rest on what it says on social media, what somebody's WhatsApp status says, what clothes you have or what you're wearing, the amount of trophies you have at home, the amount of scrolls you have on, the moment you start resting on that stuff, the moment winds come, you're not going to be able to stand secure and you're not going to be able to stand firm. Why? Because you forget whose you are. Paul tells us what we need to put our hope in. Not your marks, not your looks, not your skills, not your parents' money. So often we go to schools. We go to all schools across Alberton and into the south of Joburg. And what's so incredible, schools where they put their hope in their money, there's a different culture. Schools who put their hope in their friends and family, there's a different culture. Schools that put their hope in Jesus, there's a different culture. One of those schools we go to is a school named Dinamica. Now, hands up if you're in Dinamica. Dinamica represents. Oh, we've got this thing where we go every single Friday. And what's so incredibly interesting is that there's a hall there. And at break time, it's optional if you want to go to this hall and, you know, connect with people like-minded and press into God's word. That school, there's something different in the culture. It's a privilege to go there. It's an honor. When we go there, it's like, yes, we go into Dinamica. But sometimes when we go to other schools where perhaps the culture is a little bit different, it's a little bit more tougher. However, schools that know who they are and whose they are truly step into something else. But Paul, a man with truly unshakable faith, he went on to go write most of the Bible. He wrote this in 2 Corinthians 1 verse 7. Now, our hope for you is unshakable, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, you'll also share in God's comforting strength. Paul wrote this, and now Paul was a guy who had a lot of trouble in his life. He was beaten, he was whipped, he was bitten by a snake, he was betrayed, he was thrown in prison, he was hungry, he was thirsty, he was dehydrated, he was whipped multiple times. But yet, when he went through that suffering, he knew that God's presence rested on him. God's comfort and God's strength was on him. Why? Because he remembered whose he was. If you want to live a life of significance, you got to know whose you are. God has so many promises that he has promised for each and every one of us. But if we forget who we are, just as Simba, when he went through that identity crisis and then he fell in love. Can you feel the love tonight? There was a bit of an identity crisis. There was suffering in his life. But if we know whose we are, we won't feel a need to please people. We won't feel a need to worry about what people think. Perhaps your marks at school are not the greatest. Mine wasn't. Hello. I prayed every night before the report. Lord, please, I promise you next term I'll study. Next term came, I didn't study. Sorry, Lord, I promise you next year I'll study. But I remembered whose I was. So although my marks weren't the greatest, I still had unshakable faith in Jesus. Now, I wish I could go back in time and work harder, but I didn't define myself by my marks. I was the kind of guy who wore school clothes on Civvies Day. I know it's sad. I know. I was just that kind of guy. I had one pair of shoes that had to last me the year. It was these Puma shoes. They, looking back, I would have thrown a rock at myself for wearing them. But I loved them. But towards the end of the year, people started noticing that I only had one pair of shoes, other than my school shoes and my soccer boots. But I couldn't wear soccer boots to school. Everywhere. But I didn't base my identity in my appearance. I wasn't the most confident person in high school. I was like Raj from the Big Bang Theory. Don't laugh, I'm still getting over it. So the moment a girl would come to me, And my hands were all sweaty. My knees were weak. It was, arms were heavy. There was no vomit on my sweater. I didn't like mom's spaghetti. But on the surface, I looked calm and ready. But I needed to make sure that I had unshakable faith in Jesus, not in who I was. I needed to know who I was and whose I was in order to live an unshakable life. But can I encourage you? The moment we go back to who God created us to be, that's when we live a truly impactful life. That's when we live a life that Paul lived. That's when we start stepping into significance. That's when our life changes. So where does our faith start? Well, faith starts with trusting Jesus. Trusting Jesus always. Trust God, not the results. So perhaps you are really academic and you study. You spend hours studying. It's like 3 o'clock in the morning and you're still studying. Is that anybody in the room? We are so proud of you. I am proud of you. 7 o'clock and I'm passed out. But now, so for those of you study, and you know your work, you can quote the textbook. You walk into the exam venue and you're like, ma'am, I hope you asked this because I'm going to give you 12 bullet points to that. I know it's only out of 3, but I'm going to give you all 12. Right? And then the moment you open up the test and you start going through the questions. Know that. And then you start writing, what the freak is that now? You hit a blank. And you start thinking, but Lord, I prayed. I trusted you. Why did I fail this test? Trust God, not the results. Perhaps you a soccer team. Every time I used to play soccer, we used to pray before the game. And I pray, Lord, please, can we just annihilate this other team? In Jesus' name, amen. And at halftime, please, Lord, can the ref just call this game off? We cannot take any more of annihilation. Although we were praying, we trust God, not the results. Can I encourage you, if you're praying for your parents' relationship to change, but they're still fighting, keep on trusting God and not the results. Perhaps you have a tough relationship with your dad and you're praying, Lord, please help me and my dad. In fact, you've probably given up on your dad. Trust God, not the results. If you put your faith in what Facebook says or Instagram says or what, you know, you see on YouTube, ultimately you're going to let down. But we need to trust God, not the results. Trust God, not the results. Our faith needs to be in Jesus. Secondly, we need to have hope, right? So often we kind of just like, what's the point in hoping for something? I'm just going to get my heart broken. I'm just going to be disappointed. I don't like Christmas. Ask my wife. I don't like Christmas. So when growing up, I'm a proper, it must be a normal day on Christmas Day. But now the reason why I'm like that is because growing up, I'd always ask for presents. I'd always ask for something. And whenever Christmas Day came, I didn't get what I asked for. So I just got discouraged. Oh man, what's the point? I'm not going to get what I want. I'm not going to get what I've asked for. But we need to change our mindsets. We need to hope for the best. When you go to school in the morning, do you hope for a good day? Or do you just like, oh, double maths to start off with. This day's trash. And then you're praying. I've seen this. You're praying. Lord, please let my teacher just be at home today. Please, 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 please. And you open up the class door. You're like, hey, ma'am. So good to see you. Haven't you got a dentist appointment today or something? Can I encourage you to change your mindset? Start hoping for the best. The moment you start hoping for better things, you start trusting God, you'll see things a little bit differently. If you pray a prayer and you write down this prayer every single day, Lord, please be with me today at school. And you write down that prayer and you pray that prayer every day. You're going to start trusting God that something's going to happen. Your faith is going to increase. So if you hope for the best, something could change in your life. But even if the best doesn't come, your hope's still in Jesus. So it might not seem that you get what you want now. Ultimately, we're going to have unshakable faith. And remember, our faith is in Jesus. So we're going to have hope in Him and we're going to trust Him. And when that breakthrough comes, oh, Lord, today I had a good day. Thank you, Jesus. Something changes. Lastly, we need to have intimacy with Jesus. The word intimacy, if you break it down, is into me you see. So if you have a close friendship with somebody, You have intimacy with them. Your best friend knows you really, really well, right? Hands up if you're sitting next to your best friend. Oh, let's do the best friend challenge. Tell your best friend next to them their birthday. Wow. All right. Next best friend challenge. Look in your friend's eyes and tell them their favorite food. Some of your friends are like, oh my word, I'm actually allergic to that. Here we go, here we go. Last question. Last question. Look into your friend's eyes. Not your boyfriend or girlfriend, because then it's going to be like, Brendan, please make us say something. I can't stare at them any longer. Look into your best friend's eyes and tell them what is their dream job. Somebody's like, no, bro, I don't like that. So can I encourage you? Yeah, there we go. We'll repair your friendships in fam. We'll get over it. We'll help build your friends. All right, listen up. Listen up, listen up. I know I've broken up your friends. You can make up just now. It's okay. But listen up. Boys in the back. Girls in the middle. Dude at the back. The word intimacy, you weren't in the back. The word intimacy, into me you see. Can I encourage you that that's how Jesus sees you? Jesus knows your future job one day. Jesus knows what food you like. Jesus knows your birthday. Jesus is so passionate about you. So there's a level of intimacy. But can I ask the question, how intimate with Jesus are you? Are you spending time with him? Are you reading your Bible? Are you praying? When we sing worship songs, are you just like laughing with your friends? Like those hyenas from Lion King. Or is there, when Braden encourages you, is there a genuine intimacy? Is there praise on your tongue? Is there praise words that want to come out your mouth? Or are you more focused on the dude next to you? For those who are leaders and you want to grow closer to Jesus, are you lifting up your hands and having intimacy with Jesus? Or are you just like, yo, bro, I can't wait for the game tomorrow. It's going to be great. School was tough today. See, now there's a different level. If you have intimacy with Jesus, you start talking to Jesus. Jesus starts talking to you. You start growing. You start developing your life. You start living a richer, fuller, more purposeful life. But if you just want to stay the way you are, then you don't need intimacy with Jesus. But if you want to grow and you're passionate about life, your trust is in Jesus, your hope's in Jesus, then your intimacy will be there as well. So can I encourage you, the moment you leave those doors tonight, go home. Think about tonight. Is your trust in Jesus? Do you trust God? Or do you trust what your friend tells you? Do you trust what Oprah tells you? I don't know if you watch Oprah. That's different, Tim. Is your hope in Jesus? Or do you hope that your teacher likes you and she gives you better marks and then you'll be significant? Do you hope that one day when you step into university that you're going to study the right subjects, or do you trust God to lead you in the right way? And do you have intimacy with Jesus? If you do, you'll have unshakable faith. But it starts with a relationship with Jesus. So right across this room, everybody bow your heads, close your eyes, no one looking around. If you're holding your girlfriend's leg or arm, let go. Now's not the time to be intimate with her. Now's the time that you make the best decision in your life, a decision that will change your life forever. But it starts with making sure that you have the right place. So perhaps you're in this moment and things at home aren't going okay. Things at school aren't going okay. There's some stuff going on in your life. Perhaps watching Simba on the screen and talking about identity crisis left you feeling like, wow, that's what I'm going through. So whilst every head is bowed and eyes closed, no one's looking around, production team, their eyes are closed, my eyes are going to be closed. But if you are genuinely struggling with something tonight, you're struggling with knowing whose you are, you're struggling with knowing who you are, can I encourage you on the count of three? Let's give it to God. Just as Paul shared in his sufferings with Christ, he gave everything to Christ. Can we give everything to Jesus in this moment? So every eye's closed, head bowed. If you're struggling with identity, why don't you pop up your hand right now? Lord, we just pray that every single person's hand's gone up, you'd fill them with your presence, that they'd sense you, that they'd know exactly that you've given them a life that's worth living, a purpose that's worth achieving, dreams that are worth setting, goals that are worth working towards. I pray that you bless them with confidence. For those who are struggling, Lord, in this moment, we pray that you do something special. Holy Spirit, rest on us. You can put your hands down. There's two groups of people that I'd just love to talk to for a couple of minutes. Perhaps you've never invited Jesus into your life. You want to, you don't know why you have. Well, Jesus says these very words, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Out of all the things that Jesus said, he said many. Those are the most impactful words that he said. Why? Because he is the way. He is the truth. And he is the life. The person who we can put our faith in. He goes on to say, those who believe have everlasting life. Well, the moment you make a decision to invite Jesus into your life, you have a relationship with him, but your eternity is secure with God in heaven. And right now, in this moment, Jesus says that he stands at the door of our hearts and he knocks. And if you invite him in, he'll dine with you and you with him. Simply means that if you open up your heart to Jesus, you'll have a relationship with him. Perhaps you are another group of people. You once had that relationship with Jesus, but life happened, lockdown happened, school happened, and you've drifted away. There's no more intimacy in that relationship. Can I encourage you that Jesus is calling you back tonight? Jesus is saying, hey, I'm here. Let's do life. I want to be your friend. I want to help you. Let's have intimacy. Let's do life together. So if that's you in the first group, you've never made a decision, you want to invite Jesus into your life, or perhaps in the second group and you once had that relationship and you want to invite him back, on the count of three, can I ask you to just lift up your hand? It's not to make you feel weird or stand out, but it's simply so that I know who I'm praying for. So on the count of three, would you put up your hand if that's you? Coming back to Jesus and making the decision to invite him into your life. 1, 2, 3. Hands are going up everywhere. That's awesome. Keep them. Don't worry about the person next to you. This is a decision between you and Jesus. That's awesome. Lord, we just thank you for every single person whose hand went up. I pray that right now, Holy Spirit, that you would rest on them, that they would sense your presence. It's not about the mistakes they've made, but it's about the future that lies ahead. So come on, everybody, pray out loud with me. Dear Lord Jesus, please come into my life. Be my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sins and my mistakes. I choose to invite you into my life. In Jesus' name, everybody said? Amen. Everybody said? Amen.